When was the last time you took a flight, or even saw a plane in the sky? Planes have become so common in our lives that it's easy to take them for granted and forget that these are hundreds of tons of gravity-defying metal gliding gracefully through the sky at 30,000 feet. So in this video, we're going to break down the physics and engineering behind how that's even possible and look at how the principles of aerodynamics are actually all around us, whether in a paper airplane or a garden hose or even just driving down the streets. Now, for an aircraft in level flight, there are four forces acting on it. Gravity, or its weight pulling it down, that is opposed by an upward force called lift. Thrust, enabling it to go forward, opposed by drag, that is pulling it back. Gravity is pretty simple to understand, but we're going to break down how lift, thrust, and drag are produced, and how different components of the plane are designed to essentially control these forces depending on the phase of flight. So although the field of aerodynamics is incredibly complex, in fact, it's quite literally rocket science, I'm going to show you in this video that anyone, whether you're a pilot, a student, or a mathophobe, that you can understand at a high level how planes work using very simple beginner-friendly terms. So let's get started. So how do planes seemingly defy gravity and create lift? Well, the answer is simple. The majority of lift is generated by the wings that meet the incoming airflow at an angle, called the angle of attack. Now, this creates lift in two ways. First, the incoming airstream will be split into two paths, one above and below the wing. Now, since the wing is tilted at an angle, the air molecules below the wing will be forced into a smaller area, creating an area of high pressure. And the opposite happens above the wing, where the air molecules have a larger area to occupy, which creates an area of low pressure. Now, of course, the natural tendency for the molecules in the higher pressure area is to expand upwards toward the area of lower pressure. And hence, as a result of this attempt for equalization, the wing is pushed upwards. Now, at the same time, air molecules that hit the underside of this tilted wing are forced downwards. Now, Newton's third law tells us that for every action, there is an equal and opposite reaction. What this means in this case is that since the wing exerts a force on the incoming airflow, pushing it downwards, by Newton's third law, the air must also exert a force on the wing, pushing it upwards, and hence we have our lift. Now, these two reasons are the fundamentals behind how planes get off the ground. Now, strictly speaking, to measure the amount of lift that is produced by an airfoil, engineers use a metric called its lift coefficient that is dependent on four factors: air density, wing area, angle of attack, and airspeed. While air density and wing area don't tend to fluctuate too much for a particular flight, the airspeed becomes very important. For example, during takeoff, you'll feel the point where pilots start to lift the nose off the ground. This is to increase the aircraft's angle of attack for more lift. This point is also known as VR, or rotation speed, which tells pilots that the speed of the aircraft relative to the incoming airflow is high enough to start producing lift. Now, there is a common misconception that I want to clear up here. Many of you may have heard a different explanation for how lift is created involving an airfoil that looks like this and something called Bernoulli's principle. In this theory, people speculated that airflow travels faster above the wing than below the wing, since it needs to cover more distance in the same amount of time. And they use what is called Bernoulli's principle, which states that a fluid traveling at a higher velocity will experience higher pressure. So by this principle, since molecules travel faster above the wing, this creates an area of lower pressure than below the wing. But this theory is only partially correct. In fact, it's got its cause and effect the other way around. In fact, it's due to the angle of attack that the difference in pressure is created, and hence by the Bernoulli's principle, the difference in air velocity above and below the wing is observed. Otherwise, how would planes be able to fly upside down? And how would planes with completely flat wings fly? However, there is a very good reason why most wings today aren't completely flat, and that is to reduce drag. Drag is what pulls an aircraft backwards. Of course, in most cases, this is undesirable. Now, there are two types of drag. Parasitic drag, from the physical shape of the airplane, and induced drag, that is produced as a byproduct of lift. Now, parasitic drag is pretty easy to understand. Any object, in this case an airplane, in an airstream will disrupt airflow, essentially pushing air molecules away from its surface onto incoming airstreams. This is why when we put our hands out the window of a moving car, we feel a slight pressure pushing it backwards. Now, depending on the shape of the object, the air is displaced differently, and hence the amount of drag created also varies. This is why we see a lot of airfoils with curved cross sections, and this is to reduce drag. Now, there's also a component called skin frictional drag that is created by the airflow pushing against the different surfaces of the aircraft. So of course, the larger the frontal cross section of the airplane, the more parasitic drag it produces. Now there is also induced drag that comes whenever lift is created. Now we know that the area beneath the wing has higher pressure than above the wing, but near the wingtips, these sneaky air molecules have a shortcut, and that is instead of trying to push the wing upwards, they can simply go around the outside of the wingtip to the top instead and swirls back down onto the top of the wing. Now this creates a vortex, and as a result of these wingtip vortices, the lift force at the wingtips is actually perpendicular to the top of the wing. This means that they also contain a component that is traveling backwards, or a drag force. Now these vortices called wake turbulence are actually very dangerous as they disturb the air behind the aircraft. Now the wake turbulence caused by a larger airplane can actually be strong enough to flip smaller airplanes and make them lose control. Of course, this is why we don't see airplanes take off one right after another. Now this is also why if you ever listen to air traffic control radio, you'll hear call signs like Air Canada 123 Heavy. This is to indicate to other airplanes behind it that it is a larger aircraft with heavy wake turbulence, so stay a safe distance away. There are also many ways to minimize induced drag. For example, increasing the ratio between the length of the wing and the width of the wing, also called its aspect ratio, or by using tapered wingtips or winglets to decrease induced drag. Thrust is what allows planes to move forward, and on most civilian planes, it is produced by propellers powered by engines. Propellers work exactly in the same way as wings do, except in this case, the airfoil is simply traveling in a spiral course. Now, instead of directing the airflow downwards toward the ground to create lift, the blades of a propeller direct airflow backwards to create thrust. However, different parts of the propeller blade travel at different speeds, so in order to generate the same amount of thrust along its entire length, the angle of attack at every point needs to change. Now, this is why propeller blades are often twisted. On many smaller aircrafts, like Cessnas, the forward thrust these propellers produce alone is enough. But on commercial airliners, like a Boeing 737, these propellers are used to direct air into its jet engines. Now, we can break down what happens inside a jet engine in 5 steps. First, a large amount of air is pulled into the engine by super efficient propellers, also called turbofans. Second, the air is compressed by about 40 times its original volume. Now, this increases its pressure and its temperature. This step is necessary since it increases the amount of oxygen in the chamber, which is an essential ingredient for combustion. And at higher temperatures, reactions occur faster. Third, this compressed air is sent into a combustion chamber, where it comes into contact with streams of fuel and combusts immediately. Then, the hot air is pushed through a set of turbine blades, essentially spinning them like a windmill. Now, this turbine is connected to the turbofans in the front, powering them to spin faster and sucking more air to complete the cycle. Finally, in step 5, the large volume of hot air is then squeezed through a small opening in the back of the engine. And again, Bernoulli's principle tells us that the increase in pressure means that the hot gas is expelled at a higher velocity. This is similar to how if you hold your thumb over a garden hose, you'll notice that the water shoots out faster and with higher pressure. So now you'll understand how jet engines work. Now most of these principles hold for subsonic flight or flight below the speed of sound. And as we start to exceed the sound barrier, some of these characteristics become a little bit wonky and hence modifications need to be made for aircraft design, especially for fighter jets or reconnaissance aircrafts like the Blackbird. Now, in order not to make this video 2 hours long, we won't be diving into how supersonic flight affects thrust. However, it's definitely a very interesting topic that I recommend you research on your own. So now that we understand the different forces acting on an airplane during flights, how do pilots actually manipulate those forces to control the airplane? Well, to understand that, we have to know that the airplane has 3 basic movement axes. It can change its roll, pitch, and yaw. Now you can imagine a roll movement to be similar to rolling a burrito. In this case, rolling the plane along its fuselage. Roll is changed by the ailerons that are located on the outer section of the wing. an aileron can move to increase or decrease the angle of attack of the wing, which changes its amount of lift. Now, this imbalance in lift on the two wings creates a roll movement. Now, the second movement is the pitch, which essentially points the nose upwards or downwards. This is controlled by the elevators that are located on the horizontal stabilizer in the back of the plane. And similarly, it's able to change the amount of lift generated on the tail section of the plane. So if the tail generates more lift relative to the wings, the plane points downwards. And if the tail generates less lift, the plane points upwards. And lastly, we have a yaw movement, or the movement of the nose left and right. Just imagine the movement of a plane that is placed on a mega-sized Lazy Susan. This is controlled by the rudder located on the vertical stabilizer, which is basically a huge vertical wing that deflects air to the left or to the right. Now, by using a combination of those controls, pilots are able to navigate the airplane to mostly where they like to go. Stall happens when lift is no longer being created. The slower the aircraft flies, the slower the stream of airflow hits the wing, and hence the higher angle of attack is needed to generate lift. But when the angle of attack is too high, either from the airspeed being too low or just pilot control, lift is no longer being created. As we mentioned before, the air molecules flow downwards on top of the wing to create an area of lower pressure. However, when the angle of attack is too high, air molecules zoom past the top of the wing directly, and lift is no longer being created. This is called stall. Two things can happen once an aircraft stalls. It can go into a dive or a spin. When both wings lose lift at the same time, the plane will enter a nosedive.
No! God, please, no!
The way to recover from a dive is actually pretty counterintuitive because the pilot needs to push the nose down even further to decrease the angle of attack. Essentially, the plane needs to trade altitude for airspeed for the wings to create lift once again. This is why it's especially dangerous for planes to stall close to the ground. During a stall, what can also happen is one wing loses lift before the other and the plane will roll violently and enter a spin. Spins are a lot more difficult to recover from, and recoverability also depends on how controllable the aircraft is. For example, on planes such as the B-2, spin recovery is near impossible since the control surfaces are so limited. Now, I dive deeper into the engineering of the B-2 in an airplane anatomy episode, so feel free to go check that out if you're interested. Now, there is another factor affecting lift that we haven't talked about much, and that is air density. Now, as we get higher in altitude, the air becomes less dense. Hence, to generate the same amount of lift, the airplane needs to speed up. This is why stall speeds for airplanes increase as altitude increases as well. But airplanes also have a limit to how fast they can fly. If they exceed this, called overspeed, the aircraft is at risk for physically breaking apart or components failing. Hence, as the plane flies higher, the margin between the stall speed and the overspeed limit becomes smaller and smaller until they meet. This is what is referred to as coffin corner, and is what restricts airplanes from simply flying into space. Now, this graph is actually slightly misleading. You'll see that the overspeed limit decreases as altitude increases. Now, this is actually not because the limit is changing, but because the speed in this case is measured using an indicated airspeed, which is a sensor that measures dynamic pressure. Now, indicated airspeed is then calculated using a fixed air density, which in reality decreases as you fly higher. Hence, even if your true airspeed is the same, your indicated airspeed actually decreases as you gain altitude. This is why it might seem like the overspeed limit is decreasing as altitude increases, when in reality it stays constant throughout. So there you have it, a crash course to the basics of aerodynamics. Now, I hope that by watching this video, you have some sort of new appreciation for these magical machines that stay in the skies. And I hope that the next time you fly, just a little bit of that anxiety and frustration and sadness of traveling is replaced by a little bit of wanderlust at the plane that you're flying on. But this is just the tip of the iceberg. On my channel, I actually do a series called Airplane Anatomy, where I break down the history, the engineering, and the physics behind different airplanes. So far I've done the SR-71 Blackbird, the Supermarine Spitfire, and the Airbus A380, and many more. So feel free to go check those out. And of course, if you enjoyed this video, give it a thumbs up and share it to your friends, share it to your community. Maybe they'll enjoy it too. Now, don't forget to subscribe to my channel for new aviation content coming out, and I'll see you soon.